We have Reg Michael, who is the director of Department of Corrections for Montana. We have Paul Irby from the Bureau of Prisons. We have Judy Clarke, criminal defense attorney, and we have Chef Jeff Henderson. I have to tell you that in preparing for this panel discussion today, I have learned so much. So regardless of whether you learn anything, I've learned so much, not the least of which I'm going to be revamping the way I do sentencing, treating statements of reason, and dealing with objections. The impetus behind this program was to give all of us who have not actually been behind the bars some greater understanding of both what it is like to be behind the bars, what it is like to represent individuals who are incarcerated, and what the Bureau of Prisons faces as far as challenges and decision making. We have cards on every table, and we have runners who will pick up the cards. At any time that you have a question, please just write the question, hold it up, and we will pick up the questions and give them to Mr. Michael, who is going to be our moderator today. So, Director Michael, take it away.
Thank you all. Well, thank you, Judge, and thank you, everyone. I really do appreciate having an opportunity to come here and just be a part of this discussion, and from a broader perspective, part of this entire conference. You know, I have been a corrections professional for approximately 33 years, and that path started me out in the U.S. District Court for the Southern District of New York in 1987, and it drove me to Washington to work for the Administrative Office of the U.S. Courts, and then to Las Vegas to serve as a Deputy Chief United States Probation Officer. And toward the last 11 and a half years of my career, I was the Chief United States Probation Officer in the Southern District of Florida, down in Miami. I am now the Director of the Montana State Department of Corrections. And we are here to have a conversation with you all about what is occurring behind the bars and the transformation of the Bureau of Prisons. This panel is going to try and focus on the importance of federal judiciary relationships, our goals with our BOP partners, and the federal prison system, and the natural flow of these relationships and these goals back into the arms of the federal judiciary. We have a host of very diverse experiences on this panel with us. And they're going to speak to you, and they're going to be able to give you some history of their perspectives and their experiences serving its members who are connected to the federal judiciary and the Federal Bureau of Prisons. You know, we want to have a healthy discussion, so please, we would encourage you to try and ask questions. But you know, I'll start with, you know, my own story of prison growth. We all know this story. The story is, for the last 30 to 35 years, we've experienced exponential growth in our prison system. And for me, that experience began in 1987. I was a young 23-year-old United States probation officer, and I remember the Bureau of Prisons giving us what the BOP called a facilities manual. And some of you who are a little older will know what that manual was if you have some experience, but it was a small manual, and it was probably the size of this piece of paper, and it was no larger than a cell phone, thickness-wise. And it listed every federal prison in the United States of America in that facilities manual. So as a 23-year-old, about as ignorant can be, United States probation officer just starting my career, I learned what was in that book, and I memorized the entire prison system facilities around the country. I did that because inevitably you write a pre-sentence report and someone on the defense side would likely get up, and because we know that so many of our final resolutions of court decisions tend to center around pleas of guilt, so people would throw themselves on the mercy of the court and they would ask a judge to help them help their client. And whether they had a drug issue, whether they had a mental health issue or some other issue, they would ask for that assistance. And what the judge would do is look at me or any other probation officer and say, Officer Michael, is there any facility that you know of that you could recommend we send this individual to? I'd open up my book and I'd refer to a facility, make a recommendation, and it would be a recommendation consistent with the needs of that individual. And the judge would say, thank you very much. And she or he would then make a recommendation of placement after the sentence at one of those facilities. Now, I tell that story because you transform 30 years later as a chief United States probation officer down in Miami. I got on a regular basis, a monthly basis, a manual, an actual pamphlet from the BOP. And it was a newsletter. And at the end of that newsletter, it listed every prison in the federal prison system, along with a population count and all the facilities in that manual that used to be a manual. Is now, obviously, it's in electronic format. But they listed them on that newsletter. And I can tell you, 30 years later, I could not have possibly begun to remember every prison in this country, in the federal prison system, the way I was able to do it as a 23-year-old person who began in the system in 1987. So what that tells me is what we did as a system in 30 years, we did a lot of special things, a lot of really wonderful things. But one thing we did better than anything else and better than any other country in this world is we built prisons. We built prisons and we locked people up, and that is something that I'm hoping today's discussion and discussions that follow will help us begin to think differently about. Because what we all realize now is you can Monday morning quarterback anything. I kind of like to be a member of the playing field, so I don't like the Monday morning quarterback, but if you Monday morning quarterback, you can re-guess it and rethink it and think about all of the mistakes that were made. But the question now is, what do we do moving forward? And how do we move forward? And how do we build a new path that will help people move on? So what we have are some panel members, and I'm going to let each of them come up individually and speak, and they're going to speak about 5 or 10 minutes about some things that they want to share with each and every one of us. And we'll have a presentation with some PowerPoints and a video as well. But I'll start off with Paul, and we'd like to use first names, and that's okay, but Paul Kirby works for the Federal Bureau of Prisons, and Paul Irby is going to talk next about who he is and what his role will be. And following these brief introductions, we'll then go into a Q&A that gives us some ability to structure some questions that'll share some information with you all. And we'll also, as the judge said, give you all some opportunity to ask some questions of this panel as well. So Paul, if you would come up, please.
Thank you, Reg. My name is Paul Irby. I'm the supervisory attorney at the BOP's Designation and Sentence Computation Center. That's located in Grand Prairie, Texas, right outside of Dallas. I've worked for the agency since 2002 at the DSCC just for the past 5 years. I do have multiple opportunities to go around the country giving presentations about BOP policies, procedures. Certainly things have changed a lot just in the past 7 months with the passage of the First Step Act. If you were not at our panel presentation yesterday, I think you missed out. We had some pretty valuable and very up-to-date information on the First Step Act. If you're interested in further information on that act, I recommend going to the National Institute of Justice website. nij.gov, and they have a wealth of information as to where we are. One of the things I want to talk about with respect to the subject of transformation in the Bureau of Prisons. So as the name suggests, the Bureau of Prisons is a bureaucracy. It is slow moving to change. Some might even say glacial change at times. There are lots of obstacles that we face implementing new changes, one of which is simply the fact that we are part of the Department of Justice. We do require approval from the Deputy Attorney General's office before implementing any significant change. We also have a national union. We have a master agreement with them, and we do have to negotiate changes in working conditions with them. That can slow things down as well. But nonetheless, change does happen within the BOP over time. The First Step Act is forcing us to make some changes. Fortunately, at least thus far, those changes will be funded. The act requires funding of up to $75 million per year to implement these new programming changes that I'm very optimistic will have a very positive impact on our inmate population and reducing recidivism rates around the country. There are several things I'd like to talk about. I'm really interested in what your questions are, what you would like to talk about. So I'm going to conclude my presentation at this point and then hand it over to Judy.
Thanks, Paul. To Judy, who gets to criticize Paul. And he's a great guy. I've got 10 minutes to give you 4 hours of a defense lawyer's view of the Bureau of Prisons. I have greatest respect for Paul and for many that work in the Bureau of Prisons, but it is a country unto itself that creates its own rules and applies them fairly arbitrarily. It should be pretty telling that Congress had to step in and tell the BOP that they should not shackle a woman giving birth unless she's a flight risk. Compassionate release has to be now turned over to judges in part. That they had to be told how to calculate 54 days a year good time. I mean, I think it's telling that BOP had to be instructed by Congress to do certain very basic rational things. But I do give the BOP credit for bringing the Republicans and the Democrats together for a bipartisan bill called the First Step Act. So I have to say thanks, Paul, for that. I wanted to give you guys, are we up? Yeah. A look at what prison can be, because it seems to me that when judges are imposing sentence, they need to be thinking about where that human being is going and what risks that human being may well be exposed to. I'm not going to cop to my age or length of service as a defense lawyer in the federal courts, but we've seen the BOP go from a rehabilitative goal to a very punitive goal, and hopefully we're coming back towards the rehabilitative goal. But I think that judges often get a view of prison that is clean and pure and positive, because when you take a tour, you get the good food cooked by Chef Jeff. You get the Club Fed version of prison. So I wanted to give you a little different walkthrough. This is a New York Times picture of the AdMax, the Supermax prison at Florence, which I heard a prosecutor once describe really as a ski resort in the Rockies. Nestled in the Rocky Mountains, two hours from Denver, skiing all around. If you listen to the 60 Minutes version of what AdMax is, it is a clean version of hell. And from my vantage point, with several clients in there and having toured and visited that facility, it is truly a clean version of hell. Attorney visits are through thick glass. If you beg to have your client not shackled during this visit where you can't touch them anyway through the thick glass, they might give you a slot that you can actually speak through and actually hear what's being said. Family visits are through thick glass and telephones. You feel like you're underground because it's on the side of a hill. Inmates get to go out for outdoor rec in cages, and the outdoors is what's above. It's a truly a clean version of hell. Bureau of Prisons can be a very dangerous place to be. Headline from the Washington Post, a federal inmate threatened another for being gay, then guards moved him into the same cell. And I don't think that's an unusual problem with the number of inmates and the number of people that have to be managed in the Bureau of Prisons, but it can be severely life-changing and dangerous to inmates in there. In this particular case, the victim was serving a 9-month sentence. He was raped and forced to perform oral sex. The inmate used a duress button in his cell multiple times and tried to get the attention of security cameras. Ultimately, by virtue of a lawsuit, the feds agreed to settle the civil rights claim for $750,000. But this is a guy who was serving a 9-month prison term, and he was begging essentially to go to a cell that might have looked like this, which this is a picture of admittedly, this is an old institution in Leavenworth, the SHU, or special housing cell, where you go for protective custody in this 6 by 8 foot room, or at least close to that size. An attorney who was convicted of a child porn case, 72-year-old man whose life sort of fell apart out from under him, was killed in prison. This was not all that long ago. The child porn offenders are at great risk in our Federal Bureau of Prisons. The civil suit in that case set forth that the inmate lawyers, kept warning the Bureau of Prisons that he was at risk. He had received threats. They kept warning the Bureau of Prisons and trying to get him moved and couldn't, and he was killed. I asked a client a few years ago when I was teaching a sentencing class at Washington and Lee to write for the students what it's like to be in prison. And this was in about 2006, so we're talking 12, 13 years ago, that my client wrote this. In closing, imagine a world where you get up in the morning and before the door to your cell opens, you make sure your tennis shoes are on so if somebody jumps you, you're ready to fight. You work out hard, not for fitness, but so you can hopefully prevail in combat. You shower quickly and with your back to the wall, keeping the soap out of your eyes, and if you're beefing with somebody, you have a friend stand by the shower ready to help you. During the night, you listen and smell for either metal being scraped or plastic burning, signaling that someone is making a knife, and then recount in your head if you are beefing with anyone. A lot of people who have knives when they're among others, maybe not on them, but close by, so you're careful what you say or do. If you disrespect somebody, then you will be beaten or stabbed, often by more than one person. The next is a clip from a letter I asked the client to write and say, tell me what prison is like today. So this is, a few months ago. There are people out in the world that think you can just come into prison and do your own thing. Well, that couldn't be further from the truth. The truth is, from the second you walk into prison, whether it's a state prison or the BOP, you have to be ready to protect yourself, which means you have to be ready to fight or surround yourself with the right people, depending on your race, dictates who those right people are, or you can pay money to be protected. I know that it's ugly, but it's an ugly truth. Recreation in some of the prison facilities can look like this. Now, at least you're outside breathing the air, but the recreation is in cages. Incarceration, we now have a firm foundation for believing that it takes 2 years off. Each year in prison will take 2 years off of an individual's life expectancy. This reduces the overall life expectancy of the United States citizens. Let me go on to, and I'm doing things like Chris Hayes. I don't know if any of you watch MSNBC. Thing two, I want to talk for a minute about the pre-sentence report because I know judges and lawyers haggle over those documents quite a lot. The pre-sentence report follows the inmate throughout his or her custody. It establishes classification and designation. The classification can get increased. The level of security that you're going into a prison can get increased by virtue of not having verified prior education or that you're involved in a GED program. It's necessary to reflect programming needs, such as the drug program. Detainers and warrants on a listed in a BOP in a pre-sentence report can dramatically affect where an inmate goes to serve time and whether they can go into community corrections. One of the major problems with pre-sentence reports are unadjudicated criminal history allegations, and lawyers often come to the judges and say, that's not true, and the judge will say, I'm not considering it. Well, BOP considers it. So it either has to be redacted from the pre-sentence report, or courts have to go to the trouble of making a determination of the reliability of that information. Thing three, reprogramming and reentry. You know, it sounds wonderful to say that an inmate can go and get in a program in prison, but in many instances, they're either unavailable or the programs are full and they can't get into them, or by virtue of a detainer, they're not eligible for it, or by virtue of a finding of gun use, they're not eligible for it. There are limits on community corrections depending on what is said in the pre-sentence report. So it's really important, I think, for judges to, when they're issuing the judgment and commitment, to recommend a place of confinement. Maybe you don't want to recommend this specific institution, although I think in many instances you do. But what the courts want to do is recommend the special needs of that inmate and the special programming needs that that inmate should see. Also, in order to ensure that the person gets out into the community corrections and a path to reentry into society, recommend the maximum of community corrections time. Right now, before the first step came in, you had the eligibility for a year of community corrections, but most BOP inmates were getting about 3 or 4 months. Thing four, compassionate release. That was left to the Bureau of Prisons up until the First Step Act, and now it can come back to the courts for ruling. And typically that's a terminally ill inmate or an inmate whose family situation has dramatically put pressure on the family because he's in. The language now is for extraordinary and compelling reasons, a court can modify a sentence previously imposed. It's tremendous authority for judges to go back and relook at cases. It's no longer left in the hands of the BOP to do. And thing five, as I'm out of time, I really recommend to everyone in the audience a book called In the Place of Justice by Wilbert Rideau. I don't know whether folks remember Rideau versus Louisiana. It was a venue case in the 60s in the Supreme Court of the United States. And Wilbert served 44 years at Angola and is now out and is a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist. It's a story of transformation that we could all only hope for the people that we represent and for the people that judges sentence. It's a tremendous book and well worth reading. Thank you.
So I hope that what Judy shared with you all is not concerning. So what we're trying to do is give you a perspective that is a broad perspective that covers what is actually happening, because we think it's worth hearing and it's worth talking about. So I was not concerned to hear what she wanted to talk about. We want to have an honest discussion and we want some feedback from you all as we do that. So that was one perspective, and we'd like to bring up Mr. Jeff Henderson.
What are you doing here?
He's an ex-convict who's the first to tell you he is not proud of his early years.
Me and my sister pretty much took care of ourselves. I grew up in a neighborhood just like this one here. A lot of poverty, abandoned homes, people sleeping in cars, dealers hanging out on the corners.
Arrested for theft at 15 years old, It wasn't long before Jeff says he started selling marijuana and crack cocaine.
I was making up to $35,000 a week, and I'm sure at least $4-6 million went through my hands.
But Jeff's high-rolling lifestyle came to an end. Federal agents raided his home and arrested him. He was convicted for drug trafficking and conspiracy.
When I first went to prison, I pretty much felt that I was done. I was finished.
It's never too late to have a wake-up call. There's always time to recognize that you have the power.
I began to accept responsibility for my past. And when I went to prison and I was experimenting with food and putting out great pastries and entrees and stuff, people were like, wow, Jeff in the kitchen today.
From the prison yard to the Las Vegas Strip.
Food is one of the most important things to a person who is incarcerated.
Chef Jeff's journey has been anything but ordinary.
Prison saved my life. You know, I was rescued from the streets. But I hope these young people can make the change in their life in society today without having to go to prison and take that journey that I had to take.
He became the first African-American executive chef at Cafe Bellagio.
You know, I had to straighten up the way I walk. You know, I had to clean shave my face.
Is a New York Times best-selling author, former star of the Food Network's The Chef Jeff Project, and today is the host of the nationally syndicated television show, Flip My Food.
Hi, I'm Chef Jeff, and welcome to Flip My Food.
This is one of the better guys in the business and one of the top chefs in the country today. I gotta tell you, what a great story.
Henderson.
Welcome, Chef Jeff.
Thank you. Great morning, everyone. Great morning, everyone.
Yes, it is.
Yes, yes. First of all, I want to say that I'm extremely humbled and honored. I would have never imagined over the past three decades that I've been decriminalized, that I would ever have been invited to speak to judges that represent the Ninth Circuit. I'm gonna quickly tell you a little bit about my background and how I found success in the darkest place on earth. In early 1980s, 1982, I graduated, where I got out of high school with a certificate of completion of 12 years. Someone came up with an idea to make cocaine affordable to any and everybody in this country, known as crack. Crack was introduced in poor black and brown communities all across this country. I was there when it first hit the streets. We had no education or no knowledge that 54 grams of this hardened version of crack cocaine carried a minimum of 10 years of life. When I look back at my life of the devastation that crack has impacted black and brown communities across this country, it also became the building force of modern day mass incarceration. I was indicted by the feds in 1987, and I was sent to prison. I hold myself accountable, and I own the choices that I made in my life. I'm here to say that during this process in prison, I found a way. I had an epiphany. Like most of us who go to prisons, we blame the judge, the prosecutor, the police, the informant, our parents, everyone but ourselves. But it took time sitting in a cell with grown men in prison who came to me, who saw potential in me when no one else did, who gave me my first book that I ever read in my life from cover to cover was in prison. During that time in the early 1980s and mid-80s, BOP was considered as club fed. I walked the track with multi-millionaire stockbrokers and CEOs of corporations. I've had conversations with a federal judge, Judge Hastings, walking the track, who was an older gentleman who lost his judgeship, who saw thousands of young black men coming in the system, who empowered us by telling us that we have seeds of greatness. But it wasn't only just the cultural impact that gave me that epiphany in prison. It was a cultural diversity in prison. The first time I ever sat at a table and had a meal with a white guy was in prison. The first time I met an African an Italian, a Jewish person, or Muslim person was in prison. I was introduced to 60 Minutes in 2020 in Primetime Live. And as I begin to build these diverse relationships in prison, I begin to see the world different. I begin to read National Geographic and Wall Street Journal, New York Times. I begin to remove those blinders of poverty and ignorance off my face. And I met a Wall Street guy who I became really cool with. He ran the Toastmasters on the prison yard. They also had a think tank, a mastermind, where every Sunday the brightest minds on the prison yard would come to the library and throw a topic in the middle of the table on race, politics, religions. And for the first time in my life, I learned how to argue without getting angry. And I lost my job because I started hanging around the Wall Street guys and was late to my job on a Cadillac crew, and they sent me to the hole. And punishment when I came out of the hole, solitary confinement, was in the kitchen on pots and pan detail. And where many other inmates saw punishment, I saw an opportunity. And I began to cook, and I began to learn. And I finally found something for the first time in my life that gave me value. Food found me in prison. I never dreamed of being a chef. I never cooked before, never really worked before. And the Wall Street guy said, Jeff, when you was running a multi-million-dollar cocaine business on the street, you understood the basic principles of success, like any of us white guys in this prison. You understood marketing, branding, public relations. You manage a diverse workforce. He says, all you got to do is change the product and build character and integrity, and there's no stopping you. And that was the final aha moment for me. And when I was released from prison 22 years ago on October the 2nd, I was armed with a new mindset. I had decriminalized myself through that process, and my dream was to become a chef. I took those transferable skills I used in crime, those transferable skills I learned in prison, to set out to become a chef. I worked my way through some of Beverly Hills' top restaurants and hotels. There was a chef, a famous chef, who brought me in as a dishwasher and taught me classical French cooking. I never looked back. I ran some of the toughest kitchens on the West Coast, eventually becoming the first African-American executive chef running multi-million-dollar restaurants at Caesars and Bellagio in Las Vegas. I've written books. I've had 4 television shows. I've done all the Hollywood stuff. But when I look back at my life today, and I ask myself, am I supposed to really be a chef? And I say to myself, no. Becoming a chef was a stepping stone for me to pay it forward and go back into the system, back into the communities, to help young people who come from poverty. It doesn't matter what color you are, what demographics you come from, but come from poverty, who never had hope, who never had self-worth or value, to say that God gave us all a gift. And sometimes we discover that gift in a very dark place. So turn the federal prison system into a university, discover that gift, and come on the outside and make that happen. So as I travel the world today, I'm in prisons, I work with probation departments, I work with state probation, parole, I'm in nonprofit startups in the community, sharing my story, but also offering strategies. So today I'm hoping that we can have some great dialogue on what it really takes to change the mindset and begin to decriminalize our men and women in the prison system. Thank you much.
Thank you, Mr. Henderson. We appreciate that. So let's start the discussion, and we have some questions that we hope will get us to some content that everyone has an interest in. But if things come up, please, as I said, send those questions forward to us, and we'll try to infuse those questions into the dialogue. I'd like to first start with a question for Chef Jeff and Judy, and this question, if you would, please talk about your experience with communication between attorneys and clients in the BOP custodial environment. What has your experience been? What can we take away from it, and what might we want to consider improving?
Well, go ahead.
Well, from my experience, I had a court-appointed attorney when I was fighting my case, and I think that the lack of knowledge of law and the seriousness of the guidelines and the seriousness of, you know, the federal prison system really became difficult for us when we came to make decisions on pleading guilty or going to trial and things of that nature. I think that today in society, I think it would be very good if young people who in the community are committing crimes or living that lifestyle are educated about the consequences. Because many of us back in the 80s and the 90s probably would have made a different decision on some of the things that we did that allowed us to wind up getting in prison. I think that court-appointed attorneys have gotten a bad rap. I think there's some pretty good ones out there, and I think a lot of the attorneys today have really been able to help their clients navigate the federal system and the state system as well.
Yeah, in terms of communication, it's again one of the BOP's arbitrariness. It depends on the institution that you're dealing with. The BOP not long ago got rid of the ability of family and lawyers to send postcards to their clients to keep them, you know, connected to the world. Birthday cards are out. I assume that's because cocaine gets hidden in the cards. So the ability to keep a relationship with a client or a family member is very, very challenging today. Visitors to prisons can be, you know, drive several hundred miles and have an expired license and not get in. It depends on what your clothes are for that any individual prison, or your shoes, or for women, whether you've got on an underwire bra. I mean, there can be any number of obstacles of getting in and actually visiting with a client. I have to say that the situation has improved now that there are lawyers on site for most of the BOP facilities, so there's somebody to talk to. But it's a pretty serious problem if you want to get a client on the telephone to talk to them about an appellate issue or an issue pending in their case. It can sometimes take weeks, and you have to go through hurdles of explaining why you need to talk to the client. So it's an issue, and I know that Paul Irby is going to take care of it soon.
Absolutely. Well, thank you, Jude. Paul?
I was just joking. I was saying by Friday. No, I will say, you know, particularly when it comes to attorney client legal phone calls, those do have to be set up with the inmate's assigned correctional counselor. There has been a decrease in the staff population across the BOP for the past few years. And as a result, you do have people who ordinarily would be in place to make those phone calls happen, and they're being assigned correctional posts. Now, the good news on that is that things are now reversing. Hiring is picking up, due in no small part to the passage of the First Step Act. So hopefully those of you who have had difficulties contacting the assigned correctional counselor to schedule that phone call, hopefully that will be decreased in the near future.
Thank you, thank you. You know, I'll talk about policies really quickly, you know, because I'm now the director in Montana's correction system. I have more interaction with policy and things that happen inside the walls. And those policies are a big, big challenge for me. So I understand the BOP perspective and the challenge of trying to meet the needs of individuals who are in the environments that we're trying to serve. Well, speaking of service, I'd like to move us to question and answer and dialogue about programming. So, and this is a question maybe for Paul or Jeff. Please provide specifics about what BOP programming already exists, such as our RDAP program, and whether there are available in all BOP facilities, such as the FCIs, USPs, and other facilities that are contract facilities. So, you know, without getting too deep into the First Step Act, can you tell us something about programming within the facilities and how that program may be changing and how it's been beneficial to those who are inside custodial environments serving sentence?
Sure. So just as a kind of a preliminary matter, if you are interested in sort of our national programs, I have a prop. The BOP has a directory of national programs. see if I can get in there. It's published on our public website, www.bop.gov/resources/publications. And inside this document, there's, I think, 20-some-odd pages of all these different programs. Some are educational, some are drug abuse-related, psychology-related, et cetera. So I would strongly encourage both defense counsel and judges reviewing that. Now, this directory, it is dated May of 2017. It's somewhat outdated, but for the most part, it's still pretty accurate. It does not have a listing of which particular institutions have which particular programs, and I think that's actually a good thing. When it comes to judicial recommendations, I think I mentioned this yesterday, I strongly recommend not listing a particular facility because you think that there is a program there that would be a good fit for the defendant. Programming needs change, staff change sometimes, and if they have expertise in a particular program and they're gone, the program goes with them. So again, if you review this directory, you see a program that might be helpful to that defendant, whether it's for treatment of some kind or potentially helping them to not recidivate when they release from prison, please try to get that on the judgment as a judicial recommendation, and that will follow with the inmate as long as he's incarcerated. So we'll try to get them placed at a facility that has that program.
Programming is one of the key elements to decriminalizing in the system. Before programming can really take effect on a person serving time, there's a period of trauma that we go through fighting our case for 10, 11, 12 months, coming into a new environment of prison, especially first-time nonviolent offenders. There has to be a psychological approach and a cultural and emotional approach into making programming and educational trainings attractive to marginalized people. When I say marginalized people, I'm speaking about people who come from adverse backgrounds, communities, uneducated, second generation incarceration, grew up in poverty, because we don't see value in education because we never saw education work. So it has to be a mindset shift in these folks. So the trauma issue has to be dealt with first, is getting these folks settled in and understanding the importance of the programming inside. I'm a big component of prison occupations that are transferable to the outside. What I think the Bureau of Prisons need to do is they need to make every prison occupation certificate-based. At no cost to the Bureau, we already have the subject matter experts in prison, from brick masonry to plumbing to electrical to culinary arts to building maintenance, from buffing floors, cleaning windows, cleaning toilets. Imagine if all of those occupations that inmates have to do every single day, they added a curriculum and certificate base to that, that they can take that piece of paper when they get out of prison and say that they was a building maintenance person. They were culinary arts. They were the baker. Another challenge that we have coming out of the system with these programs is that we can't use our direct supervisors in the system as a reference when we go for a job, which becomes a huge barrier to employment. Because if you have 10 years, 15, 20 years experience working in food service, we need to be able to show that we have a work history. And we need to be able to show that we were on time, you know, we got along great with our coworkers, is that we have to bring a level of professionalism to these occupations in the system. Drug treatment, it's a big program. I was in RDAP. You know, the program really helped me understand how I became criminalized. And when you think about the pre-sentences report that's done on us before we go to prison, before we get sentenced, and that the probation gets when they get out, is really just touches the surface. The deep dive in the backstory of how we became criminalized is very important to you judges and to the probationers who write this up and who incentivize us. Because when you understand the backstory of a person, I mean way back, the parents, the socioeconomic background, you begin to understand how this person became criminalized. And then that right there is a roadmap to the treatment that we need to become uncriminalized in prison. You know, we didn't want to go to prison. We didn't want to go sell drugs. But when you have the blinders of poverty on, and drugs are the economic driving force in those communities, I mean, listen, two multi-billion dollar industries was born out of the crack cocaine epidemic. The knockoff business in hip-hop fashion was born out of that industry. We bought cars, we bought real estate, we traveled, we educated our younger children and our nieces and our nephews. There was a whole industry born out of that, and many of our parents and leadership and people in our communities turned the other cheek. But we didn't know the long-term impact that this lifestyle had on our communities across this country. We didn't know that one out of four black males would wind up in prison between the ages of 18 and 27 years of age. We don't value education, we don't value family, we don't value community, because we never seen it work. Many of these young men who were sentenced during the early 1980s and the 90s under their new sentencing guidelines, many of our mothers had to prostitute themselves to put food on the table. And when you were a young boy or a young girl, and you see different men coming out of your mother's bedroom, when you don't see your father, or your father doesn't claim you, or your father that you're claiming is really not your biological father, that's when criminal tendencies begin to set in. Because what drives our criminal, what drives our street hustle, is the fact that we want to help our mothers.
So Jeff, let me ask you this. So we've heard some of the things, programming that has helped, and some that you have some concern about. I'd like to spin towards Paul for a moment. If you could share with us, what are some of the biggest challenges that the BOP faces in providing more or different programming for the populations we're trying to serve? Jeff touched on some of the things we need to talk about, we need to consider. But from your BOP perspective, what kind of challenges are you experiencing?
In recent years, there have been funding challenges. There have been recruitment challenges. The federal government is not the glorious employer, I think, that people seek out as maybe it used to be after pay freezes and shutdowns and things of that nature. There are lots of programs the BOP has in place, but if we don't have funding, if we don't have staffing for those programs to be implemented, then they're worthless, essentially. So, certainly just funding and staffing is one issue. If we're making changes to programs, that could be, again, an issue with our union, having to negotiate changes in working conditions. That can be very time-consuming. So there are lots of different things, finding the right staff, having the money to do the programs, et cetera, working out the policies, et cetera. The ideas, I think, are in place. I think we have some very passionate people in the BOP who really want to help the inmate population, and quite frankly, once they leave the door, we don't want to see them again. We don't want them coming back as repeat customers. So again, if there's support, and certainly in the last few months, things are looking much better on that front for programming to reduce recidivism, then I think we're going to be doing a much more effective job.
Thank you. And there, here's a question from the audience that talks more specifically about programming, and this is about the RDAP program, and this question is, if RDAP is successful, which I think many of us in the audience really do believe that, speaking from the probation and pretrial services perspective, we do really, really benefit from folks who have gone through that RDAP program, but the question is, why isn't it more available in other prison facilities? We have a limited number of prisons where the RDAP program is delivered. And is there any prospect of expanding a program like that to make it more available to others?
A couple of thoughts there. One is, you may have heard that there's an RDAP waiting list. That doesn't necessarily mean that there's a queue of people lined up to participate in the program and they may miss out on the program. What that means is generally we try to put them in that program toward the tail end of their sentence, with the idea being this is intensive residential drug abuse treatment, and there might be a brief period after they complete the 9-month program before they go to an RRC to complete the approximately 4-month community transition component. But again, we have a lot. I believe last I heard we have 78 institutions. Two of them are Spanish language only, so they're catered to our Spanish language speaking inmate populations. One is for Spanish speaking female inmates, the other one is for Spanish speaking male inmates. You know, we kind of assess based on incoming people who qualify for RDAP, whether or not it's necessary to expand programs. If someone, however, does have a lengthy sentence and they just got into the system but they qualify for RDAP, they're going to remain on that wait list for a while just because it's been determined to be most effective if the actual residential portion is completed toward the end of their sentence. So I wouldn't say that we necessarily have a lack of RDAP programs out there, and we certainly are able to expand that, assuming that we are able to make appropriate staffing hires.
Okay, thank you. Another audience question is related to RRCs, and what I'd like to ask this question, maybe I'll start with Judy and give us a perspective from a defense counselor's assessment and evaluation of what goes on in the transitional period. We know that in some areas of the country, recently, some of our residential reentry centers have had to close. I believe there were 17 of those institutions and resources closed. But Judy, could you tell us from your perspective, and certainly Jeff as well, the value of residential reentry centers and what you hope to see in terms of residential reentry centers in the future? Residential reentry centers, what we commonly refer to over our lifetimes as halfway houses, who became correctional custody center facilities, and now they're residential reentry centers. So, Judy?
Immeasurable value, and the longer amount of time that somebody can have in community corrections or resident as you re-enter the community. I mean, folks have lived in an environment that I tried to describe, and I think Jeff would probably agree with me with regard to the environment, and they have to come back into our communities to live with jobs and relationships to build and changes in our society that they haven't kept up with. I had a client who didn't know how to use a cell phone when he got out. I had a client come visit me in the office and stand with his back to the wall because he was afraid. He had learned that that's how he had to protect himself. So, I mean, there's a lot of re-entry that needs to go on, and the length of time that we can get folks into re-entry programs, the longer we can get them in, the better. And I think that's a role for defense lawyers and judges and prosecutors to focus on in the judgment, recommending the maximum amount of reentry time. We've lost these reentry programs. I'm sure Paul will fix it by Friday as well.
Absolutely.
In large part because of funding issues, because the BOP needs the money to go to the correctional facilities, and the reentry programs need the money to sustain themselves. So I think it's a real problem, but the only thing that we as advocates and as judges can do is make a strong recommendation that they get the maximum amount of time.
Thank you. That kind of leads me to a dialogue about transitional services, and this question could be either Jeff or Paul, and certainly you as well, Judy, but how are the within the walls programs connected to the outside the walls programs that are used by our probation offices, such as cognitive therapy-based programming or moral reclamation therapy programming, CBT-based programming, or any other programming? What are you seeing that's happening when someone transitions back into our community, and is there a synergy between the programming that happened while they were in custody versus the programming that is delivered once someone has returned to the community?
I think it's been a strong effort in terms of probation mirroring many of the programs and initiatives that are on the inside. And I think it's important that men and women coming out of the system, you know, go to community corrections. It's important transitioning from a controlled environment to a lesser controlled environment to start that process of reintegration. I mean, some of the challenges I had coming out of prison that I didn't realize that I suffer from post-traumatic stress as well. You know, claustrophobic, paranoia, trust issues, the stone face, the seriousness, embracing family members, having contact, being in a community correction center where there's a main street out front, and you know, being engaging yourself with non folks who've been in the system. I think there's always more that could be done. I think a lot of the community correction places should have more training. I think longer periods in there is good because some folks need a longer period to adjust. I think really getting community stakeholders to buy into the importance of reentry and helping cultivate these alternative workers. You know, 650 people come out of prison every year. You know, these are all potential employees are coming back in the community, so it takes a collective of everyone. But most of the probation agencies that I've worked with over the years are doing a lot of things. They're paying for CDL license, they're paying for culinary training, they're buying tools and helping people get the tools that they need to do their job.
Great, thank you. We're gonna take another question from our audience, and this one, is there room for the community outside the prison or the legal system to work with inmates to train or mentor them while they're incarcerated? And would the BOP work with community programs and groups interested in this? What hurdles might there be?
Sure.
And maybe
I'd
for you, Paul.
Be happy to take that one. So the absolute answer is yes. There are multiple opportunities. I think every institution that I'm aware of has an assigned staff member who is a volunteer coordinator. They love to get anyone from the community who's interested in you know, working with inmates to some degree. You know, whether it's for religious purposes, whether it's for education purposes, anything, you know. I think with the First Step Act, it encourages us even further to reach out for recruiting volunteer organizations. So if that's something that anyone in this audience or someone they know might be interested in doing, I have my, you know, my hat's off to you, and I strongly recommend you pursue that.
Okay, thank you. Let's see. Research shows that the certainty of swiftness of punishment is more important than the length of sentence in determining. Now, they told me that they would give me questions that I could read, but this one, I don't know who it is, but we're working. Okay, let me read it again. Research shows that the certainty and swiftness of punishment is more important than the length of the sentence in deterring future crimes. Should federal judges impose shorter sentences within longer terms of supervision if rehabilitation and deterrence are the goal? So should our judges be considering shorter periods of confinement and longer periods of community-based supervision as an alternative?
Yes.
Please, Judy. Well, give it some context, if you would.
Can I follow up to that whenever you're done, Judy?
Yeah, please, go.
I would just say, I mean, I think every defendant has to be reviewed individually, and some people may be needing additional time incarceration. Other people may benefit from an expanded supervised release term. That question, I think it kind of bothers me on some level because it makes it sound like all people are the same, and all punishments, all sentences should be the same, and I disagree strongly with that.
You know, we have countries around the world that 15 years is an incredibly harsh sentence. And 15 years for our federal courts is really sometimes on the low end. So I do think that that has to be considered. At what point does prison have a diminishing return or an institutionalization that it's very difficult for the average person, we don't have the average guy sitting here, to overcome and come out into the community. So a little bit of prison goes a long way in my world.
You know, and I'll move off of programming for, and if, unless we have some other questions that come up, but one thing that I would like to say is, and I'd encourage everyone, when we talk about programming, whether it be in custodial corrections environments or whether it be in community corrections environments, it's really important as we move forward to focus on programming that is evidence-based, programming that's based on research and programming that has been proven to be more gainful for the people that we're trying to serve. And there is a lot of data out there that's focused on evidence-based programming that is proven to be of some value to individuals as they move forward beyond custodial environments and beyond the supervision world as well. This is a question for Judy. Jeff says, turn BOP into universities focusing on curriculum. What do you think would be the one most impactful change to the BOP if we were focusing more on education within the prisons and trying to provide services that really were centered and bound on education skills and transferable skills once they transition outside?
Yeah, I don't know how many in the room were around when the prisons had the Pell Grants, which were educational grants that could help provide education, outside educational programs for people in the institutions. That would be a tremendous thing to actually provide the programs that the BOP advertises that they provide would be a major improvement in my world.
I would agree. You know, Pell Grants, I believe they were extracted from options maybe in the early 90s, 1993, 94, but there is legislation also out there now that is proposing to move Pell Grant eligibility for inmates inside prison walls so that they can pursue higher education. So hopefully that is something that those beyond us will consider supporting because it does affect change, and if we can take advantage of opportunities to educate people, maybe we have a better opportunity for people to change.
Well, and Reggie, I don't know whether you can comment on this, but from the 40 some odd years I've been before the bar, I think it's been that long. We'll make it 15 years I've been before the bar. It seems that the Bureau of Prisons has gone from being a rehabilitative model to being a very punitive model, and that was by virtue of the politics of our country and the laws that got passed. But how to get BOP back to the rehabilitative model that I think the First Step Act is looking at, I don't know whether you can. You run a prison system. What makes it get back?
Sure. I believe that the First Step Act and what's going on nationally and what the Bureau of Prisons is trying to achieve is a huge step forward. It is a tremendous step. If we are focusing on trying to change the structure, you know, what is happening in Montana has been an effort. The 2017 Montana legislature passed a suite of bills that were focused on really trying to reduce our Montana state prison population by focusing on different laws, lower periods of confinement, lower periods of community-based supervision. In the state of Montana, we have laws which will allow people to be on supervision for 30 and 40 years. I think that's very unrealistic for any. I don't know if I could last 40 years on supervision as a parolee, to be honest with you. Things just happen. But I think that there are opportunities at this point that are very, very promising. And I think things like the First Step Act are a step forward for us. So I'm very, very encouraged, and I'm optimistic about what is going to be available to us moving ahead. Let's change I've got two questions. One deals with security. If any of you could share your thoughts on what security issues do inmates and officers face in confined environments at the Bureau of Prisons. You know, we have a lot of issues that connect with gang violence in prisons, sex offenders in prisons, and also individuals who are cooperators who might be participating in ongoing investigations or were former cooperators. What do you all see happening in custodial environments related to security? What are the issues that you have concern with, and what might you want judicial officers, members of the bar, and others to be aware of and consider moving forward?
So at least from my perspective, I can't overemphasize enough how important the PSR is. And so if you have a defendant who has some affiliation, whether they're a full-fledged member of a particular gang, or maybe they just kind of roll with them every now and then, please include that information in the PSR if at all possible. That's to that inmate's benefit. We don't want to put someone who's of a particular gang in a facility known to be hostile to that gang. We have a very large gang intelligence section within the Bureau of Prisons. They monitor comings and goings and leadership changes within the individual gangs and everything like that, and they really keep up to date on all that information. But when someone comes in and we know nothing about them, it's just kind of a crapshoot. You know, who is this person? We don't know anything about them. What gang affiliation do they have? Who should they be potentially separated from? Are there co-defendants, et cetera? There's so many particular pieces of information that we would love to see included in the PSR that will help to keep that inmate safe and potentially other inmates safe from that individual. So that, you know, information is just critical. You know, we certainly look at gang affiliations. We look at tattoos. Certain tattoos mean certain things. Don't ask me. I have no idea. But we actually have people who specialize in gang tattoos. They're subject matter experts, and they're called to court occasionally to testify. So they can make judgments really based on what does this person physically have on his or her body, indicating potential security problems. For cooperators, you know, there's difficulties there, obviously. If someone's at a facility and they mysteriously are gone on writ for 3 or 4 months and then they come back, naturally there's going to be suspicion among the inmate population that that person went out and testified against somebody else. I can tell you just, you know, every time someone comes into an institution, they are subject to a screening and they're asked, is there any reason why you might have, you know, a potential conflict with someone at this facility? Do you have any reason that there is a possible threat to you, et cetera? You know, we certainly contact AUSAs frequently when inmates are out, maybe for a Rule 35B proceeding or something like that. So we do try to keep up to date as much as possible on cooperators. We have a couple of what are called reintegration housing units. Those are specific facilities where an inmate has requested protective custody in our special housing unit, also known as the hole. And we can't verify that there's a threat to them, but they don't feel safe to come out, and so they get transferred to one of these reintegration housing units. It's sort of a step-down program to try to define specifically who they feel threatened by, define what that threat is, see what possibilities there are to move that person maybe to a more secure facility. Occasionally, we do need to move someone out of the Bureau of Prisons entirely, and so we have contracts with individual state DOCs. I don't know if Montana is one of them or not, but we will send people to outside the Bureau of Prison system for their safety if necessary. So we have lots of checks and balances, as you know, Judy displayed on her fine slideshow. There are occasionally instances where things happen, and it's unfortunate, absolutely. And we try to prevent that as best we can. We're always trying to improve the system, but you know, sometimes things unfortunately happen that we'd like to prevent.
Okay, thank you. Jeff, and you know, from your perspective, I'd like to hear from your experience with security and what you went through while you were in a contained environment. Do you have concerns that we all need to know about, that we all need to focus on some level?
Well, I'll be speaking from the other side of security versus the BOP. I wasn't privileged to a lot of those things. But for me, it's when we go, it all goes back to programming. You know, trainings, education, food, activity to keep tension down on the yard. So if, say for instance, the food gets worse because the budgets drop, they cut the budgets. There's no programming, there's no training, there's not enough positions in Unicor. There's no educational programs, no Pell Grants. Guys can't go to college, so they're not studying. So that raises heightened tension on the yard as well, which could become a security issue for correctional and for inmates as well. Like they always say, idle time is the devil's workshop. So I think keeping the inmate population busy as possible and having options for people to decriminalize and to learn a skill set that they can take on the outside. because, you know, it you know, especially in these prisons like in, you know, Arizona, you know, in Central California where the temperatures is high and, you know, it's hot and there's not enough to do. I mean, those are some pretty serious security concerns. Myself, I've never, you know, felt threatened. Again, I was in the system during a time where there was a different caliber of convicts in the federal system. It wasn't until, you know, the late 80s and 90s when a lot of gang members and organized crime was coming in. Yes.
Sure. Thank you. Judy, did you have any comments?
I don't know. I think this is just sort of the extension of your question. It goes back a lot to the pre-sentence report, and I think Paul would probably agree with this. What is in the pre-sentence report is so incredibly important.
Yes.
To what goes forward. So when a defense lawyer says about uncharged criminal conduct, that is unreliable, we dispute that conduct, unless it's either removed from the pre-sentence report or a finding is made that it is reliable, the BOP is going to rely on it. The call goes to the worst interpretation of what's in the pre-sentence report. So if somebody is saying that domestic violence incident is not true, it is an inappropriate representation of the violent history of the defendant, that needs to be resolved, or that's going to really affect where that individual can go. Warrants and detainers that could be resolved prior to the sentencing process. Probation can help with that. Defense lawyers can help with that. Come up with ways to clear out the traffic warrant or to clear out the warrant for a case that's never going to go forward because somebody's going to serve so much time in prison. That needs to go because that's going to affect the programming and affect where somebody is. The judge's determination in the statement of reasons as to the reliability of information in the pre-sentence report, if that doesn't say that is not reliable and should not be considered, then it's going to be considered. So I think that's a point I would drive home about security and safety.
Okay. Sure, and if I could just follow up on that, you know, with respect to the PSR, when we're doing our initial designation at the office where I work, we're going to err on the side of caution. So if there are unresolved or pending charges out there, that's going to be counted only for the initial designation as a detainer. So you as defense counsel out there are, I think you would be a good advocate for your client if you could help to get those resolved before they make it into the PSR. And again, if there's no mention in the statement of reasons indicating that the judge, you know, disagrees with it, you know, we're going to say, okay, the judge has put his or her official stamp on that statement. Another factor I'd like to point out with respect to PSRs, if there is sexual offense conduct listed in there, usually in the prior offense history, but the charge itself maybe is something different. For example, there was a charge maybe of sexual assault, it got pled down to simple assault, but the PSR in its description says, you know, defendant forcibly raped or forcibly assaulted, you know, the victim, et cetera. Again, when we're doing our initial designation, we look at the conduct because we're really thinking about what is it going to take to manage this individual in prison. We care less about the actual charge so long as there was a conviction or a finding of guilt. But if there's just sexual conduct listed in there and it falls under an offense that has been adjudicated, then that could potentially result in what's called a public safety factor for sex offender being applied toward your client. What that means is that individual, so long as the public safety factor is in place, would never be allowed to go to a minimum security camp, and there would be significant difficulties with finding an RRC, a halfway house, that might accept that individual, because many of them will say, we'll take any inmate from the BOP except sex offenders. So just little practice tips there.
Okay, thank you. So this is a question from the audience specifically for Jeff. And it's, Jeff, many judges impose longer sentences for general deterrence to send a message. Do you think that message is received by folks who are considering engaging in criminal behavior?
Absolutely, but I don't think anyone should be a sacrificial lamb when they have the potential to be rehabilitated. The message is out. You know, I think most in the inner city where I come from, they understand if the feds get a hold of you, it's a wrap. You can cancel Christmas. So the message of the 80s is definitely out there now. But look at the families and the lives who that got destroyed, especially for folks who were low-level dealers who got indicted on massive CCE charges. Many guys, when I was in the MCC San Diego, were all in a holding tank on massive indictments. Most of them didn't even know each other. No one ever knew what a conspiracy was. I mean, these were totally uneducated folks who just got raided by the DEA, the Narcotics Task Force, and brought into the system. So the message is definitely there, you know. And I think now with the different drugs out now, you know, with the pills and the different types of drug dictates who does criminal drug cases. You know, crack, you know, is not a choice anymore like it once was. You know, there's many other drugs out there now. So I think that, you know, the message is there. You know, I think, again, why people do what they do. It's easy to say that, you know, make the right choices, get the best consequences. But when you come from an environment when you just can't figure that out, it has to be something done to give. If you give these guys and gals this amount of time, there has to be a way out. And I think the first step is the first step in that process to where hopefully many of you judges can go back and look at these individuals and see how they've been programming in the system, and it should be a way they can come back and get resentenced.
You know, if the length of a sentence made that much difference, we wouldn't have 165,000 people in federal prison now. We'd still be at the 15,000 level. Because over the last 30 years, we've just increased the length of sentences, and it hasn't worked to decrease the people coming before the federal courts. So I don't know that does it.
I know we're getting, thank you, Judy. We're running close to our end, but I'd like to talk. This is a question from the audience as well, and a different topic, and it's open to any of us. And the question is, how can we justify for-profit prisons? And I have an opinion, but I will start with the members of the panel.
Sure.
And for you first, Paul.
I will answer, which is the Bureau of Prisons has no control over who is charged with a crime. We have no control over who is found guilty of having committed that crime, and we have no control over who is sentenced for that conviction. All we have control over is managing the number of inmates who have been sentenced. We do have a finite number of facilities that we can use. When we hit our limit there, we do have to resort to contract facilities, and that is just a fact of life. I recognize there are issues people have, certainly with the private corrections industry. I'm not blind to it. It looks bad to a degree, people profiting off of incarceration like that. However, at least so long as we have anything close to the inmate population we have right now, we are out of options. Building a new federal prison, first of all, is politically tricky. It's also extraordinarily expensive. And just getting approval from Congress for one additional prison is heavy lifting. So we do use the private contract facilities, and I do believe, at least for the time being, they are a necessity.
You know, the Sentencing Commission could have a role in this, and that is by changing the guidelines to reflect a reduction for those people who don't need to be in prison and provide this relief valve to let more people who don't need to be in for the period of time that they were in to let them out. I don't know what your thinking is.
Yeah. Well, you know, the whole private prison industry, I mean, we can debate that for a whole month. You know, from my standpoint, what my fight is through community reform. I say we shut the private prison industry down and mass incarceration by stopping our young people from becoming criminalized. So if we can connect with young people of color and people of poverty and say, you have a gift, here's options for you instead of crime. Here's a way out of poverty into your own version of the American dream. That's how we shut these prisons down. And that's my fight. I'm not a politician. I don't really understand all the political stuff, but I know crime is a multi-billion dollar industry. Last numbers I got is $182 billion industry. And when I looked at the food, $2.8 billion a year is spent on food, feeding every person incarcerated, 2.3 million people in this country. Who's selling the flour to the prisons, the chicken, the salt and pepper? It's big business.
Sure.
And when I tell people when I go into the community that it's not going anywhere, prisons ain't going anywhere. Crime is here, but you gotta make the choice. Is the consequences worth it? So that's my fight. Thank you.
Thank you all for that. I'd like to shift to, and these are a couple of questions that are specific to our judicial officers. And for either of you, what do you wish judges knew, and what do you wish judges would think about before sentencing? And we can start with either of you. There are a lot of judicial faces in the audience, and they want to hear.
I will say one thing. So Families Against Mandatory Minimums has a sort of a promotion right now where they're suggesting everybody visit a prison at least once a year. I would suggest, if you're a judge, visit a federal prison at least once in the next 365 days. I just think that getting perspective on the lives of people who you were sentencing is very valuable and relevant. I think, you know, sometimes there are misconceptions about what goes on in prisons, and naturally, if you're going on a tour, you're probably not going to see a typical day in the life. You'll see kind of a VIP tour, but it will give you an idea, I think, in general, of how prisons are these days. Judy, do you have anything you want to add there?
Well, I think prisons are pretty rough these days.
Well, but I think just
but to, I think that's right.
You know what I mean? There's just lots of information out there, and some of it's true, some of it's false, and I would just encourage these judges who are imposing these sentences, you know, take a close look at what these facilities are, and it may impact the way you do sentencing from now on.
I mean, I think the BOP has a rough, rocky road. They don't have enough staff, they don't have enough money, they don't have enough ability to do what Paul may want them to do. And judges sort of figure, well, I'm going to leave it up to the BOP. So I think as courts, we need to be very aggressive in helping the BOP define what they need. We can't just leave it up to the BOP. I think we need to realize that a little bit of prison goes a long way. And I think Paul's suggestion that judges actually visit the real prisons out there is a great one. I think Judge Peterson visited USP Atlanta a couple of years ago, and that was a very different experience for her than visiting what the BOP might recommend be visited. I think that, you know, BOP spends about $2 a day on food for inmates. That's pretty incredible. So I think judges should realize how horrible the prison experience can be, that there are some of the folks like Jeff and Wilbert Rideau who can transform, but some other lives we're really crushing by the links of prison.
Thank you. Jeff, did you have a second?
Yes. I think for me, visiting prisons is great to give you a perspective on how people are serving time and how things are working. But I think I want to go a little step further and say that, you know, coming from middle class America and not having a cultural and emotional connection to lower class America and educated folks, people in poverty, is to do a community tour, you know, a listening tour. Go to where some of your customers, your cases come from, to really get an understanding on why certain demographics of people are doing what they're doing. There's a reason behind that. Every one of you became a judge because you discovered something about you, a gift. Someone saw something in you, allowed you to be on that trajectory to do what you do today, to do what I do today. So when you understand the people, the subcultures, in these communities, it'll help you give perspective when you're sentencing these folks that come through the court system. That's my area of expertise, is that group of folks. So I think it's important to try culturally, emotionally, to connect, because there's no one shoe fits all sizes. I believe that everybody needs their own blueprint, because our traumas are different. Even though they may seem the same, but our traumas are truly different. And it's a world that you may not understand. But, you know, throw a wig on and cruise down in the hood and, you know, and don't have no makeup on. And I just sit back and observe. Because as a little boy, quick story, I'll go.
And we're on time, Joseph.
We're out of time? Yeah. Okay.
So, I mean, we're on time, but go ahead and share the story. Share the story, but we're on time.
We want the story.
Okay. When I was a little boy, I got bused out of South Central L.A. to Culver City. And as a little boy, every day, I rushed to get on the seat behind the bus driver because it had a huge window. And every day for many years, I saw middle-class America, which fueled my dream to one day to be able to get a house on a hill with a white picket fence for my mother, who struggled. Who my father left, divorced my mom when we were young. My mother came from generational poverty. And so I was exposed to the middle class world through vision looking out of that window. And for you to be able to truly understand why certain demographics of people commit specific and certain crimes, you have to go amongst that to truly understand. I mean, that's all I can say. I mean, you know, in my precinct's report, they say, you know, I was a gang member. I'd never been involved with gangs in my life, even though I dealt with them in terms of business, but I never was an active gang member. I had potential, but no one ever saw that. So many of these young people, you know, there's opportunities to, you know, tie your legacy into believing into some of these folks that they can change.
Thank you. Thank you. I know we're on the time clock now, and I'll try and simply close very quickly by just, you know, the First Step Act, it creates an opportunity for us, an opportunity to do more than we've been doing over the past 35 years in the federal correction system and in similar systems around this country. But I will share this with you. There are thousands of Chef Jeffs in this United States of America who are struggling through custodial environments, and they have skill sets, and they have potential, they have goals, and they have a desire to change. We have an opportunity, and we have to take advantage of the opportunities that are available to us and to reach towards people and move them and pull them back into society as productive, contributing members of our world. Because they will get out one way or the other, so we have to do that. Thank you all for listening to us. Thank you for the questions. We really do appreciate it. Chef Jeff, I appreciate it. One day, I hope to benefit from your skills and sit down and have a meal with you.
Well, next year, we have a judge cook-off. How's that?
Thank you all.
Battle top ramen noodles.
Thank you.